Hello, as you know, I'm Teodoro Montanaro, and I will present you a really fast introduction about Android. So, it is a really fast introduction, so it is not complete, and it will only provide you some superficial notions about Android. So, if you want to learn morphine, you have to self-learn, so looking at the documentation that is available online and learn by yourself all you need. So we are explaining Android because we think that you will need it during the development of your projects. So I will start with a really short history about Android, and then I will explain you the information you need about the platform, and then I will pass directly to the development of an Android application, a really easy Android application. So, Android was originally created by Andy Rubin, so it was not created by Google as you think, but it was acquired by Google in 2005. Now it is maintained by the Open Handset Alliance that is led by Google. So this is the reason why we think that Google created it, but it is not right. As you can see in the screenshot and in the table, we are currently at the version 7.1 or better. It is the stable version because we are at the 8th version of Android that developers are starting to test and that you can try by installing the SDK and so not on your smartphones but in the emulator. Okay. So let's go fast. We are explaining Android because there are a lot of mobile devices that currently run Android and so let's start with the introduction about the platform. What is Android? Android is not only the operating system, but it is an open source software stack. So it is composed by both the operating system and the software platform for creating apps and games. That is what we are going to see. The development tools are free, and it is another reason why we choose to present you Android instead of other platforms. And Android, it is important to say that Android applications are written in Java programming language. So if you don't know Java, at first you should learn Java and then start to create Android application, or better, look at Java, a really brief study of Java, and then going to Android application because to develop Android application because however the documentation is enough to do what you want to do, even though you don't know all the things that constitute Android, excuse me, Java. However, let's go on and let's start with the architecture. As I told you, the Android operating system is a stack software. Is a stack, so there are a lot of software components as you can see in the picture. It's difficult to hear me. Then, okay, in this way you should listen me. Okay, it is a stack. So as you can see, there are a lot of different components. The first one I will present you is the Linux kernel. Android is based on the Linux kernel for a lot of reasons. One of these is that it can take advantages from the Linux kernel. So, for example, security features are already implemented. So, who developed Android decided to use existing one. Okay. As you know, computer engineers, and not only computer engineers, but people that works in computers usually start from existing things, don't do things that already exist. So this is the reason why usually you find something that already exists in software, let's say. However, it's not so important, so go to the other component, that is the hardware abstraction layer that provides an interface between the Linux kernel and the API that are in the next level. It consists of multiple libraries that implement, for example, the camera driver, the Bluetooth driver, and so on. Why I explained it? Because if you need to, for example, implement an app that should connect using the Bluetooth, you have to know how does it work, so you have to find information about the module that implemented it in the hardware abstraction layer. So the other, and this is really important thing, is that is the Android runtime. What is it? Each app in Android runs in its own process that is instantiated on the Android runtime. And what is important is that exists one instance of the Android runtime for each application. Why it is important? Because if you need to access information, files, resources from other application, you need to exit your runtime environment, so using, for example, permissions. So you have to declare in your application what are the permissions that you want to use to exit your runtime and access other application runtimes. So I will say you a lot of other things in the next slides, but just to understand why it is important because every app has its own instance of the Android runtime. However, in the first sentence, you see that ART, A-R-T, is the actual Android runtime because it was and it substituted the Dalvik runtime that was implemented in the previous version of Android before the 5.0 version. Okay. Then the other components are not so important. However, the native libraries were written in C and C++, and this is another reason that let you, for example, implement some modules or maybe application in C and C++ if you want, but it is not recommended because all the support is for Java development. Then this is what you will use, that is the Java API framework that provide you a feature set of the Android operating system and let you implement your application. So this implements the methods that you will use in your application to do everything. So for example, to show the user a specific view. So this is the part in which what you need is implemented. Then the last layer, the last component, is the application layer, in which I have to say that Android comes with a set of core applications, but the important thing is that the Android operating system doesn't make any distinction between system application and let's say third-party applications. So the calculator that is already installed on your mobile, on your smartphone, is the same, is considered as the same, at the same layer as the application that you will build. So let's start directly to see what is needed to implement an Android application. So the first thing that we usually do when we want to develop an application, not only in Android, is to design it, as you know. So Android provides you a guide to develop applications that are well done, let's say. So in Android 5, Google introduced the material design metaphor What is it? It is based on three main principles. The first one, we can say that summarizes all the others. As you can see in the slide, the first principle is summarized in this, in the phrase "material is the metaphor." Excuse me for English, for my English. So, what does it mean? That what you are building should be considered as an object. Why? Because, as the slide said, an object is more fun than a button or a menu. So, when you build your application, you should think that what the user will use is something that is, let's say, real. So, you have, and these are the other two principles, you have to, let's say, insert everything thinking that it is important. So, bold graphics are intentional. So, if you use the bold character, you should think about the thing that it is important. Let's say, you don't use the bold characters to show the date of last update of your website. It is a really unimportant, useless information. So, this is what they are saying. Don't use things that people consider important to show information that are not, for example. And moreover, motion provides should be meaningful. So, for example, if you swipe on the left, it should, for example, do something. And if you swipe on the right, something else. So every action should have a reaction in your app. And it should be important, or you should implement it so that the user can understand that you thought about it, instead of using, for example, the bold for unimportant things. So, another important pattern that is used in the best practices of the development of Android application is the model view controller pattern. What is a pattern? A pattern is a common solution to common problems. So someone, excuse me, I will try to connect it again on the schedule. Okay, you can hear, can you hear me? I hope. Okay, I was saying that the patterns are things, in this way, the registration will know. Sorry. A pattern is a common solution to common problems. So, someone said you that when you have to implement when you have to implement something that has something similar to what we are going to develop, you should use it. Let's see what is it. The model view controller is based on three main components. The first one is the view. What is it? It is the interface that users see. So it represents the aspect of your app. And so what the pattern says is that you should implement it by differentiating it from the other ones that are the model that implement the data model. So when you want to show something to the user, the view will be the aspect of your application. Instead, the model will be the model of your data. And then there is another component, that is the controller, that is what connects them. So, let's say you have an application that shows user, for example, the appointment, let's say, to dentist, I don't know. And what you should do is, in the view, you should implement only the aspect of your app. So, for example, a table. But no data are inserted in this view now. Then, in the model, you will create the model of your data. So, for example, date and what is the appointment of the day. And in the controller, you will implement the code that will bring the data from the model and insert it in the view. So, developing Android application, this is the way we should develop everything. We should follow, okay? However, today we will only develop an easy application in which we will not have a model because it is a simple calculator, so we will have only the controller that do everything. But in the next lesson we will implement a to-do list manager as usual. You already implemented it, but now we will implement it on Android, and in that situation I will show you how to differentiate the different components of the pattern. Well, to develop an Android application, what you need is the Java SDK. As I told you, you will develop using Java. The Android SDK, the an Android development environment like Android Studio, and an Android emulator. If you download the Android Studio installer from the website, official website, you will automatically have the Android SDK, Android Studio, and the emulator. However, you can use whatever you want. Before the development of Android Studio, people used Eclipse, for example. And considering that the emulator that Eclipse provided, there were a lot of other emulators from third parties to emulate your application that were faster than the one provided by Eclipse. However, Android Studio provides you whatever you need to develop a simple application just for your needs. Okay. Other things that you need before starting to develop the application are some notions about how and what is needed in the Android application. So, as I told you, Android apps are written in Java programming language. Each process, as I told you before, each process is run in its own virtual machine, the ART, as I told you, the Android runtime. And so the apps code runs in isolation from other apps. Here you can find some details about it. So Android operating system is a multi-user Linux system, and each app is considered as a different user. Okay. However, these are the important components of an Android application. They are activities, services, content providers, and broadcast. Today I will present only you, I will present you only the activities, and in the next lesson I will dedicate 3 or 4 minutes to present the other ones, but developing the application is better to explain them, so I will explain them during the development of the second application, the to-do list, as I told you. Okay, each component takes care about something in the life cycle of your application, however we will see it. So let's start from the activity. What is an activity? An activity is a single screen, is a single interface, what the user see, but the word single is important because every time, for example, there is an example here, an email app should have, for example, 3 different activities. One for showing a list of new emails, the other one for let you compose an email, and the other one to read emails. So every activity that user should perform in your application should have its own activity. Okay. So a main activity is mandatory in every application because each app starts from the main activity. So if the main activity doesn't exist, the app doesn't know what to show to the user. This is the reason why we need a main activity in each application. Okay, when a new activity starts, it is pushed onto the back stack and takes user focus. I will explain you what are the possible status of the activity so that you will understand better this sentence. However, take it into consideration now. Okay. This is the life cycle. So when the app, let's say, is started, the main activity is started too. And this is the possible, let's say, the life cycle of an activity. So at the beginning, the method on create will be started, then the on start and so on, looking at the graph. Why I decided to show you this thing? Because when you implement the application, you have to specify them. Okay, this is a zoom in which you can see the on create method, the on start method. So you have to specify what each method should do. So coming back. For example, let's say you are developing an email application in which at the startup all the emails should be taken from the server. Where you should do it? In the on create method or in the on start method, because they are at the beginning of the step. Moreover, let's say for example you are implementing a game in which the user play for some times and accumulate some points. If suddenly, let's say, a WhatsApp message arrives, the user click on it, and what happens? Your application is goes in the background. So what happens? Happens that the onPause method is called. And then, when you click again on your app, the onResume method is called. What is important is to save your points in the onPause method and then take them in the onResume one, just to let the user begin from the point at which it ended. So, in this lesson, I will only show you what to do in the onCreate and onStart method, but remember that the other methods exist, because when you have to do something else, you have to implement everything in the right method, otherwise something should not work. So, I tried to explain you it in an example. However, the onCreate method is called in two different situations. The first one is when the app is running for the first time. Instead, the other one is when the activity is launched again after being terminated. So, for example, you go in another activity and then you come back to the first one. In this situation, the onCreate method, is called again. It is always followed by the onStart method that is called when activity is becoming visible to the user. So the onCreate is called, let's say, in the background. Instead, the onStart is called always in the background, but when the user, when the app comes visible to the user. Here you find some other information about the other methods that are called in the following, but now I will start to create with you a simple calculator application. So, hoping that the computer will not crash, I will open Android Studio. Click the play button, just because otherwise the emulator will take a lot of time to execute, and then I will show you how to create a new project. So close project. Okay, when you open for the first time Android Studio, you will see something like this. The list on the left is empty, but not in my case. And you can click the link.
So for example, if you want to start a new Android Studio project, you have to click the start a new Android Studio project. So I will do it. Let's do it. So what Android Studio asks you? An application name. So for example, very fast calculator. Even though very fast should be very fast, but I don't know. AMI calculator. Okay. And the company domain is only it's not really important. Why Android Studio ask you for the domain? Because if you are developing let's say two different apps that are called in the same way, the domain will differentiate them. So for example, if I'm working at I don't know, a company, the Politecnico of Torino, let's say, and I'm working too at the Politecnico of Milano, okay, and I'm developing the same application for both of them, but they do different things, I will call them in the same way, but the domain will be different. However, it's not so important. It is only the path, let's say, in the on the file system. So, for example, if you write here elite.polito.it and the name of application is AMI calculator, in the file system it will create a folder that is called AMI calculator, then a folder that is called IT, then a folder that is called Polito, a folder one inside the other one, elite, and then the real files. However, it's not important, don't worry, excuse me, it's difficult to explain it, but it's not so important, don't worry. Then you have to choose the location, whatever you want. Yeah. I choose. Let's create a new folder. Folder. Trial. Okay. Okay. Next. Here it asks you what is the target platform for which you want to develop your application. Here are some information about the spread of each version of Android. So, for example, you want to reach 40% of people, you can choose Android 0.5. If you want to reach more people, you can choose, for example, Android 4.0, and in this way, your app will be supported by Android 4.0 and higher. However, in this situation, I will choose the 5.0 because of the design, the material design I told you, because in this way it will help me design in the right way. Otherwise, I have to implement it by myself. So I choose 5.0. Then I have to select the template I want to use, so I will choose an empty activity because I think it's the best one. Next, it is the name of the main activity. I told you it is necessary to implement the main activity, so this is the name of it, and then I click finish to create the project. Okay, now I will show you what I was saying about the path, the domain. If I go on the desktop and in the trial folder, here is the AMI, excuse me, you can see it, right? Okay. It enlarged only the icon instead of the... Okay, you have to trust me. Here is AMI calculator. Then inside the AMI calculator you find the app folder in which, okay, the SRC folder, and then in the main folder in the Java, okay, here is the path. So IT, then Polito, then Elite, then a NEI calculator, and then the really file in which you develop the application. However, it's not so important, as I told you. Here,
okay,
you should see it. However, I can expand it. Okay, you can see it. No. Okay. So I will use the slides to explain the parts of the application. However, now that I just created the let's say an empty application, I can start it and showing you that it is already runnable, let's say. So okay, to run an application, it is the important part. You have to click on the play button or using the menu run app. In this way, Android Studio will ask you what is the device on which you want to run the application. If you have a connected device, a physical connected device, you can run it on your smartphone, but you have to enable the debug mode. I will show you if we have time, otherwise I will show you it in the next lesson. Otherwise, there is the possibility to run the application on an emulated device. Here I've already created a lot of different emulated devices. Even though at the first run of Android Studio, you have to create the first one. So clicking on create new virtual device, it will ask you if it is a phone, a tablet, a wearable device, or a TV, and it will show you a list of common devices, for example, the Nexus 5 or Nexus 4 and so on, with the settings. So for example, what is the size of the screen and so on. I choose the Nexus 5X device, and then I go on. Here I have to choose what is the version of Android that I want to run on it. So I choose Lollipop, that is 5.1, and that is API level 22. You will find more information about the API level on the documentation as usual. So then I click next. Here I have to specify a name for this emulator. If I want to start it in portrait on landscape mode, and other things that are not so important, then if I click on finish, it will create something like the ones that are already available here. Now, if you remember, I clicked on run, so now I can run the application on the created emulated devices. So if I click OK, it will open the emulator, that I opened it before because it takes some time, and it will build the application showing it in the emulator. Let's wait a few seconds. Okay, as you can see, this is the simple application we created. At default, if you select an empty activity, it will create an activity in which there is only a the hello world sentence, let's say. Okay, it is the simpler app that you can create. Now let's analyze how this app is made, so that we can understand which are the blocks in which we have to implement our code. Here, as usual, I think you can see this. Let's try to zoom again. However, I will not continue to increment the size of the text. However, I will show you each of them in the slides. So, coming back to the slides, okay, this is the same screen that you were seeing, and it is a zoom.
Excuse me.
Okay, so the first folder is manifests, in which there is the file called Android manifest. What is it? The manifest file is the most important file in an application, in Android application, because it specifies every characteristics of your application. If I'm not wrong, okay. In fact, every single component that is implemented in your application should be declared in this file. Every permission that you want to request to the user or whoever, to the operating system, you should be specified in this file. Every other configuration setting should be specified in this file. There is here an example of the manifest file, in which you can see, I hope you can see, okay, in which, okay, here,
oops,
okay, here at the beginning we have an example of a user permission. So in this situation our application will need the read from state permission. What is it? It is a permission to access the status of the smartphone or the device that is in use. This permission, if I'm not wrong, should be asked directly to user. Why I'm saying it? Because in Android 6, Android started to ask user for permissions, for some specific permission. In the previous version, you had to accept them installing the app. Instead, from Android 6, the permission should be asked to the user in real time. So every time you need to access the phone state, you have to check if the user has already permitted it. Otherwise, you have to ask him. Or for example, if you want to access the Wi-Fi status, you have to check if the Wi-Fi status was already permitted by the user, and if not, you have to ask him. So this is the difference between an Android 5.0 application and an Android 6.0 application, and so on. Moreover, here we have other important things, in which, for example, the application tag is used to specify all the other all components. In this case, there is only one activity, so there is the activity tag that says Android that our application has only one activity. If you, for example, develop an activity, then you copy the file, the specific file that implements that activity, and paste it with another name, and you forgot to specify this file in this file, in this manifest file, it will not work. Why? Because everything should be declared in this file. So every time you copy and paste something, you don't have to forget to insert that thing in this file. Okay, there are other things that are not important now. Then, another... So, the other important file is that, let's say, the other important folder is the Java one, in which all the code, the Java code, should be inserted. Here we have the main activity class that implements the main activity and contains the class definition. So, what happens when the app is built and run? The activity starts and runs the contained code. Here is, okay, the last sentence says you that the activity just implement the controller that we saw in the MVC controller pattern. Here is an example. This is the class that implemented the main activity. As you can see, it's simply Java. And the main activity here implement only the onCreate method. So we say to Android that every time the main activity is run, a set content view method is called. Okay, don't care now about this method. However, this is what is executed when the app is run at first. Okay. Then there is the REST folder that contains all the resources for the application, and it represents, let's say, the view of the MVC pattern. There are a lot of folders in this folder, and in the REST folder. The first one is the drawable density one. What is density? If you develop, for example, your application and you want to use a different image for different resolution on your screen, you create a different folder for each resolution you want to support. So in density you will insert the resolution that you want to support, that it is not in pixel but in something like MDHI, so the I don't know the name, the code of that kind of resolution, let's say. Okay, for television you have the full HD, HD ready and so on. For Android there is something similar that's specified by a name what is the resolution that is supported. You can find this information on the documentation as usual. Okay. Then there is the layout folder, that is the directory that contains the user interface. So here you implement the real interface of your app, and we will see it later, I hope. Then there is the menu folder, in which you can define the menus of your app. Then the mipmap, in which you should insert the icons of your app. And the values folder, that is important because every string or let's say color, every changeable value of your application should be specified here. So for example, you are implementing your application for both the English and Italian languages. Here you declare two different files, one for Italian and the other one for the English, in which you say that the string hello is substituted by hello world in English and by ciao mondo in Italian. So in this folder you define everything that is changeable, let's say, in your app. So the color, for example, the strings, the we will see it in the implementation of the app. Excuse me. Then. Again, perfect. Let's wait just a second. However, it was time to go in Android and the studio to implement the app. So I hope it will not crash now. There was just an example of the layout. Okay, here it is. Let's explain it so that, because we had it, okay. Sorry, today my computer decided to work not so good. Let's try again. This is an example of the layout, so don't look at the code but look at the interface. You can create your view by using the design mode. So you see, let's say, a simple smartphone, and you can insert every element you want to implement in your interface by simply drag and drop it. So, and Android Studio will create for you the code for it. This is the code that Android Studio will create for you. So in this example, in which there is only an hello world text, this is the code that implemented a text view in which the text is hello world. However, let's go to the application. Here you can find some layout alternatives that I inserted because I will use them. They are some possible ways of put your elements in the page. So the linear layout, for example, let you insert elements vertically or horizontally. Then relative layout let you insert elements by specifying the distance from other elements, and so on. There is the web view to load the web page, or the list view to load the list, grid view to load the list of elements in a grid view. However, these are some widgets that we will see in the implementation, and we can go to the real implementation of our application. Okay, here we have the Hello World application we developed. If we want to implement a calculator, we can, let's see, we designed it, so we want to implement it so that it can be similar to this one. So we have some text box in which the user can insert some numbers and then some buttons that perform the real operation. So let's start from the insertion of these elements in the view, and then we will implement the code that actually perform the operations. So as I told you, we have to implement the view, the interface, we have to modify the layout. This is the layout associated to the main activity. We can see it by looking at the code here you can see that the activity to which this layout is associated is the main activity one that is specified in this way. So let's start to modify the view. It's important to choose the right version of Android you are going to develop, for which you are going to develop your app. In this way, in this case, I will select the API 2.21 that, if you remember, was specified when I created the app. Waiting for Android Studio. I selected 21, but okay. I'm trying to zoom and wait for the computer. We choose to use this computer because it should be faster than the one provided in the classroom, but as usual, it's not so. However, I don't know what to do. Okay. Let you see everything. I zoomed it so that it's difficult to use every command, but I will try to do it in any case. Here we have the interface that Android Studio provides you to implementing interface of your app. Here, as I told you, there is only a hello world text. I delete it now because I want to create my own interface view. And so here, as I told you, I have, first of all, I have to select the layout. So here, if I click on the layouts, I can see that there are a lot of layouts. For example, we can choose the relative layout, in which, as I told you, I can specify the distance from each element, specifying that from the other one. Okay, I will show you. So, just a moment. We want to implement something like this, and okay, first of all, we want to insert a label for the first number. Okay, looking at the documentation, we can see that there are two different types, not only two, but two main different types of text box. The first one is the plain text, and the other one is the text view. The text view is for elements that user doesn't have to change. Instead, the plain text is the one that the user can change. So I will use the text view for the label. Okay, and I will write number one as label here. On the right, you can see the properties of each element. So here, I will write, instead of text view, I will write when the computer will let me write, I will write number one. Okay, so I'm inserting the label, so number one. Then I press enter, and if I want to modify the size of the text, I have to click on more properties and select, if I'm not wrong, text size here, and select, for example, 24. Okay, then I will insert a plain text to actually let user insert the number one and some other label. Okay. Okay, then I will insert four buttons, one for the plus, one for the minus, one for multiplication, and one for the division. Okay, and finally a label for the result. As you can see, the arrows indicate you what are the elements from which the elements you are inserting depends. This is the way it is called, relative layout. And finally, text view for the result. So this is the label. And I can write result. Okay. Then instead it is the field for the actual result, so I insert here 0, and I will assign an ID because I need it to get this element from the activity implementation for the controller to insert the real value, the calculated value. So the ID, for example, could be result. Result text, for example. Then I need to assign an ID to the number two text, for example, number two text. Okay, yes, and to the second, so excuse me, for the first number one text.
don't care about what it is asking. Then I will insert 0 in both the text box. Okay, and I need to specify that user should insert only numbers, so I will click again on view all properties, and then I will go to the property that is input type. It is at the beginning because alphabetic number order is not so common. Input type, and I will deselect text person, and I will select only number, and it's difficult to see. Okay, number and number sign, for example, if I want to support only number and signed number. Then I will do the same for the second number. So input type, I will deselect text person name, and I will select number and number sign. Okay, in this way Android will not let me insert something that is different from number. Okay, now I have to assign different ID to the button. For example, plus button, yes, minus button, times button. And let's say the button. Okay. Now we have all the elements we need to create the real calculator. What we have to do? We have to, by code, by the controller, to take the values that the user insert in each text box, and then when it click on the buttons, we should calculate the result and insert the result in the right text view. How to do it? How can we do it? We will look on the internet, because the documentation is our best friend, and hoping that Chrome will not crash again the system. I will search for button Android, for example. It is a way to, this is the official documentation. So now I looked on Google, but you can search for it directly on the documentation. We will do it next minutes, okay? As you can see here, the documentation says that there are two different ways of saying Android what to do when a button is pushed, and one of them is to assign a method to our button in the XML, that is the code I showed you here. So in the design view, we can select text that is in the bottom, and in this way we can see the code that was automatically generated for implementing our interface. In this code we can specify what should be performed when a user click on the button. So for example, the button here is the plus button, and here adding the on click, if I'm not wrong, on click method, we can specify what are the code that should be executed when the user click on it, and this code should be specified in a method in our controller. So I will copy this part, that is a simple implementation of a method,
and I will paste it in our main activity. So this is a method that accepts a view. Android Studio will help you import all the classes that are needed, and it show you the key that you should press to import them. So for example, in this way, in this case, we should press Alt Enter to import the view class. Okay. Now we can call it, for example, plus. This is a function that should perform the plus operation. Now, in this function, this method, we should take the value from the text view, excuse me, from the edit text element, number one, number two, and then calculate the result by performing an addition. How we do it? As usual, we look on the documentation, we search for, okay, if we look at design mode, we can see that the first element is an edit view. You can see it in the properties. Now it's late, so I will, you have to trust me. And we search for edit text in the documentation. Here is the widget that we used, and looking at it, we can see that there is the property that is called get text. However, we have to get the element and then use the method. How we can get it? We can search for accessing resources, because we have to access resource. Okay. This is the right link. And if you look at what they say you that you can use this kind of code to get the resource you want to access and then use that the method that it implements. So the find view by ID is the main method that lets you access the resources. So let's copy it, and coming back to our code, let's paste, and instead of use image view, we have to use the text edit element. So text edit. Edit text, sorry. Edit text. We have finished. I need only, let's say, 5 minutes more. Edit text. Okay. Text, and here I have to specify what is the ID of my element, that is number one text. So number one text, it helps me. Thank you. Then I have to import the edit text class, so Alt Enter, and now I can get the number from this element. So number one equal to edit text point get text. We saw it on the documentation, get text. Okay, now there is an error, because get text returns a string, so we had to convert it, and we can do it. We should look at documentation, but as usual, you can trust me, and the best way to do it is by performing okay, string dot value, string. Yeah, it's integer dot parseInt. Okay. In this way, it is converting the text in an integer. However, if we look at the error, the get text don't return a string but an editable element, and we have to convert it in a real string. To do it, we use the method it should be toString, right? to string. Okay. Now there are not. There is not any error. We do it the same. We do the same thing for the number 2. Okay. Edit text 2. Number 2. Okay. Now we can perform the operation, so int result equal to number 1 plus number 2, okay, and then we have to insert it in the result view, that is a text view instead of an edit text. Looking at the documentation, you can see that the best way to do it is using the setText method, and so we do it. So text view equal to I can commit text view. And the name, the ID was result text. Result text, perfect. Now I can do a text view dot set text. Okay. So, looking at the documentation, the set text doesn't accept integer, so I have to convert it again in string, and I can do it by using the string dot value of method. So in this way we will see, okay, the last passage is to assign it to the button. So coming back to the interface, click on the button, and in the right panel, in the right list, we will find the onClick element. On click. Here it is. And we can choose the plus method. In this way, when we click on the first button, we will see the result. We should see the result. Now, I will try to execute, hoping that the computer will not crash. And okay, we should see the resulting application. Obviously it is not completed. We can implement a different method for each button, so the minus one, the division and the multiplication, and to complete the application. We publish the complete, let's say, calculator on GitHub as usual, so that you can see the code, but it is similar to the one I already implemented. So I have only to copy the method plus that I just created 4 times, so that we can have all the recurrent methods. This is the reason why I loaded it at the beginning, but my computer decided that the memory was not enough to have all the things executed, and so we have to wait to do it. Okay, here is our application. If we click on the button, if it performs the operation, but however, inserting 2 and for example 4 here, clicking on button, here is 6 that you cannot see because it is too too little, let's say, but okay. However, as usual, trust me, you will see it in the registration. Okay, I finished for today. Next lesson I will show the complete version of this calculator, and we will go through the implementation of the next application to list, hoping that the computer will support us. So I will start some minutes, let's say, instead of starting at 4 and 15, I will start at 4, so that if we have some problems, we have enough time to complete everything. Okay, thank you, and sorry again for the problems. Okay.